Hey there, viewers, welcome back. Sorry about the delay on this one. I did get the parts right away, but I was a couple days behind on getting it together, so yeah, the camper's all together and long gone by the time you see this, but a little delayed getting the video out. At any rate, we're right back to where we started. You've seen in the first video, simply just removed the wheel, we removed the hubcap, we took the cotter pin and the wheel nut off, pulled it out. Give you a quick example of how the electric brakes worked. If you didn't see that video, there'll be a link in the description or floating around here somewhere on the page, and you can go ahead and check that out. So now that we got that off, I'll show you the parts we got. We got brand new Dexter brake assemblies, and they were considerably cheaper than, you know, like I mentioned in the first video, than buying all the components separate. So that's why we're doing it this way, and I'm gonna show you how I go about that. Well, first thing first, we've got all our new parts. Hopefully they're right. We're gonna get these old backing plates off. It's a piece of cake. We just gotta cut these two wires. Now they're, being it's electromagnet, they're not polarity sensitive. So we're just gonna cut them. You can see there's just two green wires there, whatever wires they put in when they ran these through. So we're just gonna cut those connectors. And we're gonna pull the four nuts off the flange. You'll see them all the way around. These ones take an 11/16. So we're gonna bust those loose, cut the wires, and slip this off. Crack loose. I'm gonna grab an air ratchet. Pretty much falls off. There you have it. That was pretty simple. Just want to leave, you know, usually there's plenty of wire hanging out of these things. You just got to do that. I'm going to do that times four on this trailer. I'm not going to record the whole process, so I'll be back when the other ones are off. Well, I didn't think I was going to record it, but I think we did it pretty quick. So at any rate, I'm going to go around now. Just take a rag. We're going to clean up all these spindles, get all the old grease and crap off them. So we're repacking wheel bearings, so we want to get as much of the old stuff off here as we can. No video is really complete on the SMA unless we got brake parts cleaner. So we'll use that to clean out the stuff out of the threads, blast out the cotter pin hole there. Get them all cleaned up and ready to go. You'll notice when you get your new brake assemblies, or you might notice when you order them, it says right hand. That's one thing about electric brakes, there's a right and a left. There's no front or back, just right or left. And that's all, that just dictates which way the pendulum swings, I guess. As you'll notice, this is a right hand assembly. Oh, sweet, free packet of candy. Save that for later. Comes with a couple brake adjuster hole covers. And you get a whole brand new assembly ready to go. And it has also has a stamp in it too on the inside, on that white sticker says right hand. So, and like I say, the only difference is what way they have this arm oriented, you know, left to right. So, yeah, that's pretty much it. These things are ready to go. And I think that is, you know, just based on which, you know, if it hits the primary or the secondary shoe first, and you know, how it transfers friction to the other shoe. Because like a conventional car brake, you know, you've got the longer shoe in the rear, the shorter shoe in the front. You know, and then the equalization, I believe, is transferred across the adjuster at the bottom. So, because this doesn't have a wheel cylinder, you know, pushing out on both sides. But, you know, if you don't understand the concept of these, you can poke around on YouTube, or you can even look at my first video. I explained how the electromagnet is actually a wear item on this. Also, you know, how it catches the drum and, you know, slings it forward and activates the brake shoe here. So you can see it activates the rear shoe first. You know, which is what we'd expect, so. So that's a right hand. Let me open up a left hand and I'll just stick them side by side and you'll see what I'm saying. It's just the difference of the arm here. Forgot my knife. It's kind of frustrating. I went to grab it about 15 times and didn't have it. So here's our left hand. Another free bag of candy. I can't believe it. Today's my lucky day. So you can see the difference there. It's just the actuator arm or pendulum arm or, you know, whatever terminology you want to use there, but that's the only difference. Other than that, they're completely the same. So. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and put them on. I did see it came with some paperwork. Take a quick look at that. Like I said, these are right from Dexter. You can get these Dexter brand ones the same price or possibly cheaper than you can get some crappy aftermarket ones. Just a bunch of safety crap, using jack stands, that type of stuff. It does give us some torque specs here. To install using new hardware, blah, blah, blah. It gives us a torque spec on a 10-inch brake. If it's a 7/16 20 hex nut, which is what we have. These are 7/16 threads. Yep. Tells us to torque it from 45 to 70 foot-pounds. That's quite a broad range. So, that's that. I'm sure yours will come with paperwork. Let's put these babies on and get this thing done. You know what, I'm just gonna set this on. One more thing that's easier to show now. Another bag of candy. That's awesome. On the back, where your wires come through, you've got this little wire retainer. I believe it is a one-time use deal, so once you get your wires around the back, and we'll hook them up however you're gonna do it, whether you're gonna, you know, solder them or, you know, heat shrink connectors, whatever, you know, we'll loop them around and then we'll retain them with this little plastic retainer here. We'll get the wires in it, loop it around, click them down. Let me grab one of the old assemblies. So here's one of the old ones. That's what they look like once they're retained down. Like I said, I think they're a one-time use deal. And, all right, enough talking. So, simply enough, we're just reversing the process here. Just gonna put them together, spin the nuts back on them, tighten them down, hook our wires up. Pretty easy. So there you have it. Same thing on the left side, just use the appropriate brakes, obviously. I tell you, I usually record inside. There's people walking by. They must think I'm a lunatic. They're gathering up their small children. Come here, Marge. The guy's talking to himself. Get on the other side of the street. Well, now that I've got all four assemblies on, believe it or not, I got four good packages of candy with each brake. Talk about lucky. Probably the best thing to do is hook up the wires. So I'll grab my stuff to do that. Like I say, it's all, this stuff gets kind of repetitious because what you do to one, you do to the other ones. So I'll show you how to hook up one set of the wires, and it's pretty straightforward. Just got to hook up both wires. Doesn't matter where they go. All right, it's pretty simple. Just going to take the two wires on my axle. Take and strip those back. Oh wow, they look like they're a pretty small gauge. These ones have a inner and an outer insulation. Oh, I'm gonna cut that back off. Boy, that could really trick you. If you didn't have good eyesight and you just stripped that, you wouldn't actually be down to the wire. Huh. Wonder if that just gives it some extra abrasion resistance or what the thought is there. Be darned. You know, these ones are very, very similar too. An extremely thick insulation. I guess I've never really paid much attention to that. You know, it looks like it might be like 16 gauge wire, but gosh, when you go to strip it, it's awful small on the inside. Now you can do whatever you want with these, whatever your method is or preferred method. I'm going to use the heat shrink buck connectors, which are totally fine, before you give me a whole bunch of grief about it. I've used a bazillion of these things, but never had any problem. However, I would not recommend a standard, you know, just open butt connector. So I'll get these crimped on there, and then we'll shrink them down. What I like best about these connectors is not only that they provide a great, you know, positive seal because we crimp it, but they're cooling right now, so I'm not going to flex it very much. But when you heat them and they shrink to the wire, they have this epoxy that squeezes out of them, so it makes just a perfect weather-tight seal. Once they've cooled down, if that's the method you chose to use, just want to loop our wires, lock them back in that tab just to give us some free play, so in the future if there's ever anything that needs to be done, you know, we've got plenty of wire, those wire retainers there, hopefully you can see it in the video, we'll hold that wire, and that's pretty much all you got to do. Just go around and do all the rest of the wheels. Getting late. People keep stopping in. I keep shutting the camera off and I keep falling behind. At any rate, I'd like to have this done before the sun goes down. I decided to work on this after hours because I just need to get it done. I've got a little dedicated trailer testing box I built many, many years ago. I'm gonna grab that, grab my jump pack. We're gonna hook it up. I'll show you how that works. You guys might be interested in that. They're pretty simple to make. I think they manufacture them now, but I built this long before they made one. What we're gonna do is energize the magnets. We're gonna come back with a screwdriver or something, make sure they've got power going to them. And then we'll do the wheel bearings. Okay, so simple enough, that's all this is. I've just got a 7-prong and a 4-prong, your two common trailer ones. I've wired myself up some trailer brakes, reverse and running lights, left and right turn, complete with a flasher. I just use an old, just a box I bought from Kmart. Like I said, I've had this for many, many years. On the inside, wired it up with toggle switches, a fuse box, I wired in a flasher, and then I bought a power distribution box from down in Napa. Everything's fuse protected. You got a main fuse going into it, and then I've got a main power LED on the front to let me know if something shorted and it blew my main fuse. So that's just hooked in series there. So pretty simple box. You can make one. I think you can buy one for a couple $100, but you can make one pretty much for peanuts. So I'll just plug the trailer in. Turn on the trailer brakes, and theoretically, if all is well, we'll go back there and be able to stick a something to our magnet. Get this hook back up. So right now our trailer brakes are energized, and you can see they easily hold a pair of pliers, and they just have to be powerful enough to hold friction against the drum, so as the drum passes by, it activates that shoe, forward and reverse, so you can see that easily has enough power, but then it also allows it to slip by, so obviously the drum has more surface area than, these pliers, so, it'll contact the hole magnet. Go check the other side. Hey, getting hungry. Didn't eat much for lunch today. Anyhow, we've got our brake drums in here, and we've got the inner and outer bearing braces for each one. So this is a pretty simple part. I mean, the whole job's been pretty simple. It just gets monotonous, because once you've done it once, you got to do it three more times. So you try to find a method that works the best, and I find that just whatever I do on one wheel, I zip around and do it all the rest of the wheels. I've got the stuff in my hand. Some guys employ the method where they work on one wheel and then they put that together and then they go tear the next one apart and put that together. Whatever. It all gets the job done. So you will notice, because I'm not putting in new bearings, that I labeled each brake drum before I tore it apart. Like this one, for example, is off the left front. Don't know if it makes a difference or not, but they are bearing and races and they've run together. So I'm gonna put them back together. I don't even really have a theory on it, but in the event that I just threw them all in the parts washer and mixed them all up, and a week later this guy's wheel bearing goes bad, I'd be wondering, is it because I mixed them up? I don't know. This way I don't have to wonder. I've got the new seals. I don't have them right out here, but seal's the seal. These ones aren't very fancy, so that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna pop the seals out. Gonna clean up the drum assemblies one at a time, blow them all out. We're gonna bring them back over here, and then we're gonna repack the bearings, pop in new seals, put them on, adjust the brakes, get them all bled out. I'm just kidding. You don't have to bleed these out, and we're done. Deja vu, man. Don't reuse your cotter pins, throw them in the garbage. Make sure you pick up some new ones. It This is where it's real handy to have a parts washer. If not, if you didn't have one, I guess what I would do, if I were doing this at home, is lots of brake cleaner. You know I love that stuff. All kidding aside, yeah, lots of brake cleaner. I guess what I would do is first I would clean out the hub where the majority of the grease is, the best I could. Like with a roll of paper towels, you know, you get a roll of paper towels, super cheap. Just start scooping the crap out of there. You know, I'm just gonna keep washing it until it all rinses out. But yeah, that's probably what I'd do. I'd scoop it out. You can get, like, if you go down to like Dollar General or something, you can get like these cheap brushes. You know, it may work good. Start, you know, like here, I'll use the parts washer and just, you know, go like that. I've got tons of different kinds of brushes and just little cheap crappy ones you get at the store. You know, they fit all kinds of stuff. You use them until they're bad, then throw them away, and you're only out a buck or two. So that's my thought there. I'd scoop it all out best I could, and I'd just start hosing it out with brake parts cleaner. Whatever you got, probably somebody you can leave in your comments if you have a better suggestion. I don't get out in the world much, so there might be some latest greatest, maybe a water soluble degreaser. I don't know. All I know is you gotta get it all out of there. And even though that houses the majority of the grease, the hardest thing to clean is the bearings. And I guess what I would do if I had air but no parts washer, I might take a blow nozzle and just blast around it. You know, just keep going around the race, you know, between the bearings, and just blast the grease out. And then, you know, maybe you just use some diesel fuel or kerosene or something you can just dunk them down into and, you know, do something like that, and then dispose of your kerosene properly, or gas, or whatever you use. I don't know. I was a kid. I didn't have parts cleaner. I just used gas. Like, oh, I need to clean this off. Let me dump a little gas out of the carburetor. You know, if you're working on like your mini bikes and your motorcycles and crap, like, you know, whatever I had when I was a kid. You know, lawnmowers. I was a big fan on lawnmowers. I had a lot of lawnmowers. And I guess as you're watching this, time for a little BS story. So when I was a kid, I had a mower, a 1972 LT Grant was the brand of it, and it was pretty small, and it was, my dad had his shop here, and so I took and I brought it in, and it had little tiny wheels on the back, like little 8-inch wheels, and I really wanted this thing to go fast, because, you know, when you're 12 or however old I was, I didn't have any mode of transportation other than my two legs, you know, whether I wanted to pedal or walk. So I was always trying to fashion ways out of stuff I would get at yard sales. Lawnmowers, mower engines, anything that would run, I would do whatever it took to buy it, you know. You know, most kids nowadays want video games. All I wanted was a used lawnmower. That's all I wanted. I knew I could never afford a four-wheeler or a moped, you know, when I was young, but I could usually afford a broken push mower. That sounds ridiculous, but that's just the way I was. But anyhow, back to the Grant. So I had this Grant. So I brought it in, and I found out in my dad's metal dumpster a set of used 15-inch rims. So I took the small wheel, and I welded it inside of the big rim, and then I mounted up two junk tires on it. And I all of a sudden had a lawnmower that would do about 30. I was so proud. And, of course, you know, I did it when my dad wasn't here, you know, probably some of his employees. And I decided I should drive it back to my house, which, you know, I lived with my parents, obviously. And that was about 2 miles away from here. And so I just decided, well, I'll just go right up the road. And I didn't even make it to the end of Main Street here. Yeah, I got pulled over on a lawnmower. And they promptly made me return back here to my shop, and which I got in trouble and all that stuff. So my dad was nice enough to take it home though for me, which was awesome, because then I drove the snot out of that thing, and it was really sweet because it had a Briggs & Stratton engine in it, and it was one of those ones where the exhaust manifold was actually just like a 3/4-inch pipe thread. So the next thing was, being that I was a kid, is I wanted it loud and obnoxious. So one time when my mom was downtown, I got a piece of black pipe at the hardware store that was threaded. And I might be wrong in its size. Maybe it's like inch whatever it was, you get the point. And I brought it back here because I enjoyed welding when I was a kid. And I cut it all apart and I fabricated myself a set of custom dual exhaust out the back straight pipes off this baby. And it was ridiculously loud. And I would drive the thing up to my friend's house and all over the place. It was like my little four-wheeler. And it had little 4-inch hard rubber front tires. It was awful to drive, especially at top speed on blacktop. Once it started getting all dirty, you'd almost eat it every time. So, that's one story. I have multiple others. There. There, everything is clean and dry and back on the bench. I got my bag of oil seals. I'm gonna make sure they're right. The OD of them is right. They look a lot like the old ones. We'll go slip one on the axle, make sure the ID is correct, which I'm sure it is. They don't make a lot of different seals and bearings and stuff when it comes to these trailer axles. You know, if it's a 3,000 pound Dexter with a 5 lug, it's usually, it is what it is. But so what I'm gonna do now, everything's clean and dry, is I'm gonna pack the bearings. You can pack them the old fashioned way. You can get a handful of grease, one of my fondest childhood memories, and you can sit there pushing the grease through until it comes out the other side. I'm gonna use my Easy Squeeze. It's a bearing pack I've had forever. You just fill it up with grease. What we're gonna do is drop the bearing in and then push it down. What that does is it forces the grease up through all the needles on the bearing. So you'll see all the little red dots coming through. That ensures that the grease is all the way through. Once that's done, I'm gonna take a little bit of the excess grease. I'm gonna wipe it around the outer portion of the race. Drop my bearing in and that one's done. I'm gonna go on and do my inner. That one's packed. I'm just gonna stick it in my metal cup simply because that one's not ready to go on at this point. We'll put that one on when we put the drum on the vehicle. I'm gonna go through and get the rest of my bearings packed, stick them in their appropriate drum, and after that we'll put the seals in. Got all the bearings packed. Tell you that if you do enough trailer brakes or, you know, drum brakes. Yeah, I want to say drum brakes because typically drum brakes aren't like this unless they're on a trailer. Well, I suppose they could if you're working on an old enough car. Or maybe, you know, disc brakes on an old two-wheel drive where you had this. The little bearing packers are nice. A couple different styles. They've got another one that's like two tapered cones. You put the bearing in, you spin the two cones together, you put your grease gun on it, you pump it full. They work great. I actually had one of those when I worked at my dad's shop. I don't know where it is. It may be still there. So now I'm gonna take, I did verify that the seal is correct. I'm just gonna use a seal driver. Don't forget to put your bearing in. I'm gonna put my seal in. Just like that. Keep going around until that's done. Oops. I don't want to damage it. We'll start over here. There, all of our seals are done. What I like to do after that is done is typically I'll take my bearing squeezer here and I'll push it down to get a bunch of grease pushed out of it. Or you can use, if you're using your bucket of grease or whatever. I'll just take some here and I'll wipe it on the inside edge of that lip of this seal. And I'll kind of squeeze some there between the space of the bearing and the seal. And I'll just use a gob on each one. Just kind of go through there and work that in. And our bearing's already packed, so we don't have to worry so much about that. You know, we know we've got plenty of grease in the needles of the bearing, and essentially that should be all we need. You know, we don't need to jam this whole hub right full of grease. Usually what I'll do, and it's just always been my habit, you'll find a lot of controversy on this. I don't know if it's controversy, but maybe different techniques. And I think, this is strictly my opinion, I think we do what we do because it's what we're shown, you know? Like I say, it's one of my earliest childhood memories is what you got to do when you're a kid. You got to pack bearings. And that was awesome, you know, because you're like in the shop, you're working with like, you know, the guys, and you're just a kid, but you're packing bearings like a champ. So I think we do what we're shown. So it's been my habit, you know, the bearings packed, that should be good enough. I usually just take a gob of grease anyways. I go on that outer bearing, and I reach in as far as I can on that hub, and I just kind of twirl it around. But I don't know why. And I'll admit it. I'm not afraid to admit it. So once I got this baby flipped over, I stick my other bearing on. I'm ready to go. I come along and I do it to the next one. I flip it over. Get my big booger of grease right on that race. Then I go inside the hub and I kind of twirl it around. And I've tried to tell myself why I do that, but I couldn't even come up with a good enough excuse other than the fact that I think I do it because that's what I did when I was a kid. Perhaps it combats moisture buildup. I don't know. It doesn't eliminate moisture because you still have moisture on top of the grease. I don't really know. I'd like to hear your thoughts on what you do or how you do it. I mean, I know guys that take these caps and they pack them right full, and you know, I've seen all different kinds of methods, you know, or heard all types of different ones. You know, particularly if somebody's watching me pack bearings, you know, even some old codger, you know, he'll say, you know, you gotta fill that hub full. Well, I think I've done enough research and stuff on it to know that you don't. And when these things come from the factory, you know, they're not full. Not saying that they do it right, but all they do is pack their bearing, stick the bearing in. Theoretically, all that grease should stay on there. I don't believe that it liquefies, melts off. I think if you got it that hot, you've got bigger problems. I know you'll ask, what kind of grease do I use? This is a Valvoline. I think it's considered the Valvoline multi-purpose, American, Japanese, disc drum brake certified grease. If you're watching this video and you're doing it on your boat trailer, they take a special grease. They use a marine grease. So make sure you got the right grease for your application. This grease more than exceeds the spec and heat requirements of this drum brake, so. All right, they're all done. It's almost dark out. I wanna get this job done. I think about coming in the morning. I hope that you guys will be able to see. I'll load this stuff back on the cart and we'll get her back outside. All right, we're back outside. I'm gonna take a little bit of grease on the surface of the seal here. We don't want that getting dry started. So we got that lubed up a little bit. I know some guys that I actually, you know, never seize under the, or not never seize under bearings, wipe a little bit of grease under where the bearing race is gonna sit to the spindle, hopefully to keep that from seizing up, but yeah, I think we got plenty of grease on there. So we're gonna take our drum, make sure they're good and clean and dry, you know, definitely hose them out with some brake parts cleaner prior to put these on. So, and basically line them up and just try to put them on straight so you don't damage your seal. That would be critical. I reinstall the washer. Put the nut back on. Now this is where you'll find like 100 different old timer methods. You know, me, I like to just take them down. I run them down tight for the first time, give them a little spin. That way if there's, I don't know why, any grease or something impeding, you know, the bearings pushing together. I just like to make sure the bearings are seated in there good. You know, just do a couple times, get them tight. And usually what I do is I just take them off, take them hand tight. So you can, I mean, you can feel where it stops. And that's it. You've seen when I took them off, it did not require any tools. And we'll get our cotter pin pushed through here. Let's see which, if I can see that stinking hole there. Of course, they don't drill these straight. Always seems there's like just a smidge off of the castle nut. So, take and bend our cotter pin over. Find my cutters and we'll chop it off. There, send them babies flying. That's that. Take a cat. You see, like I said, some guys pack them. I just have that little bit of residual grease in there. It doesn't really do anything, anyways. So we got our grease cap on there. All we got to do now is put all the rest of them on and then go through and adjust our brakes. When it's all done, there should be zero free play in that. Bearings just tight enough to take up the free play and not any tighter. I don't know if that's the exact method. You might want to research that a little bit. Method I've always used, never had a comeback, so I keep going with it. Say just a little grease on that, oops, on that lip there will be just fine. Stick that on nice and straight. Just like that. By the time you do the fourth one, you get good at it. A little dirt there on my washer. Stick our washer on. Stick the nut on and repeat the process. I'd be interested to see what kind of feedback we get on this video. You guys are usually pretty good about your comments and your methods. I always enjoy hearing different things. I hate these in-between ones. Usually if they're in between, I usually back it off just slightly. One thing I will caution you on, so I bent the cotter pin around the front like that, no big deal. When you put the cap on, make sure when that cap's all the way on, that cotter pin is not scraping on the cap when it goes around. If it does, it'll burn a hole right through that sucker. Usually you can hear it. So that's just brake dragging. But if that cotter pin is hitting, you'll hear like this tinny, scrapey sound. You know, a sound like a cotter pin hitting a tin cap, that type of sound.
It is now time to adjust the brakes.
Okay, all kidding aside. Time to adjust the brakes. I probably should have showed you how that was done prior to putting the drum on. I've already thrown the old ones in the scrap metal bin and I don't feel like going and getting them, but at any rate, there's a star adjuster wheel on there. We're going to reach it through the back side of these brake drums and you'll see it if you haven't put your drum on, or maybe you want to look at your old ones. We've got the adjuster wheel at the bottom of the shoes. We just got to take and start cranking it through the back side of the drum here in one of the slots they provided. Until we can't turn the wheel anymore, then we're going to back it off a few clicks and we'll know that the shoes are fully adjusted. Just the method I use always seem to work. Okay, so crawl under here and you might ask yourself, and this is a good question, is what way do I turn the adjuster? Do I click it up or do I click it down? I can answer that very shortly. Whatever way that you think it goes the opposite. So I think, like, I should click it down. So I'm going to click it up just to prove this concept. I'm going to have to move the camera. I cannot reach around like this. Let me see here. See if I can do this. So right now I'm spinning the drum. Somebody's actually mowing their lawn. It's literally almost dark out here. Street lights are coming on. So I'm going to start turning this adjuster wheel up. And you'll start feeling some drag on the brake. Yep, like right there. So right now the brake's dragging. And what I do is I just keep giving it a few clicks to make sure the shoes are out all the way. So once I've got the brake drum locked up, I'm just gonna come back. Two or three clicks there, still feels like it has some resistance. So that's four clicks. I can just hear some drag and it turns pretty easy. So that's where I'm gonna leave it. Just had to grab the bag. You remember the four packages of free candy they gave us, which is totally awesome, I might add. They also gave us these little rubber brake adjuster hole covers. How's that? So we take these and we just pop them in there. Because if it's like any other trailer brake, these things will never be touched or adjusted ever again. And that's it. But if this is your trailer, make sure you adjust these. Take this thing for a ride, burnish in the shoes, bring it back, jack it up, double check the brake adjustment, and you should be good for a while. So I know before I get asked, you're gonna wanna know what I'm using. It's just your standard brake spoon. It's a Snap-on one, I've had it for a long time. You can't see the number, well, maybe you can. Probably got too much glimmer on it. You can use a screwdriver, you don't have to have anything fancy. Just on this one, it's a pain because somebody put the jack stands right in the way. And it's dark and I can't see very well. Okay, that's locked up. Usually I like them so they got just a little bit of drag. Just about like that. Particularly when they're new, because they're gonna burnish in pretty quick. Thanks for a long day. I guess it'd be 9 o'clock at night and you came in at 6 o'clock to get started. In the morning it is. Shh. It's pretty quiet here. It's about to get louder. So when you spin it there, you'll hear just that little bit of slight drag. And that's it. All right, we made it back inside. It's all done. I think everybody's woke up now. So I keep the town people happy. Let them know I'm still here. They don't mind. There is a 10 o'clock curfew here though. The whistle blows one time at 10 o'clock. I think that's when all the little hoodlums are supposed to go home if they're wandering the street, I don't know. Okay, a couple things. Let's try to dead end some questions. What impact are you using? This one. It's made by Top Tool. I don't think you can really buy it. One of my friends sent it to me. It's a wonderful tool, and it's quite small. I like it. I use it because it makes him happy when he watches my videos. Seal driver. Just standard seal driver set. You can probably pick these up anywhere. This one's a Mac. These are all the different discs that go in it. The discs, their purpose is to hold the spring in the seal as you install it, which I did not show, which I should have. Sometimes I just do things that are rogue because I've done them forever. And I try to explain the best that I can when I remember how. Bearing packer. It's called an easy squeeze. Got just a dust cover here. You fill it up from your grease gun, pack your bearings. probably Google it. I don't remember where I bought it. I've had it for many, many years. Seal driver, El Cheapo, modified. Comes with one little crapper screw through it when you buy it, doesn't work. But when you weld it, it works perfectly. Blow nozzle. It was a Mac. Torque stick. AccuTorque probably. Here's my brake spoon. That one's a snap-on. Don't waste your money on it, because you can just bend a screwdriver if you need to, and it'll work just fine for what you're doing. I use my DeWalt 12-volt tools. It is my light. Ooh, bright. The mini torch I dropped on the way inside. That's a power probe. I've had a lot of different mini torches. The failing point on every one of them has been the spout. As you notice, that this one is starting to get the downward droop. I break all my own. I have them on my bench, they fall over, I bust the end off them. We buy another one. Should be more careful, but I'm not. The 3/8 impact is a Air Pro U. That's how it's done. My friend Denny, he sells these things. He imports them directly. This is a wonderful, wonderful little tool. This is, look how small this thing is. It's reactionless and like 55 foot-pounds. It's amazing. This thing has some serious torque. It's awesome. He sells these things. I think by now he's sold out, but I think he's getting in more. So when that happens, I'll keep you posted. Everybody always asks me about this. This thing is awesome. Can't say enough about that. Okay. And the candy? Total disappointment. I ate one bag. Stuff tastes like crap. And my throat's dry now. And last, thirdly, I think I had three things I wanted to share. Butt connectors. They're going to say, what butt connectors do you use? Well, these are just ones from Napa. So they come in a multitude of varieties. I've got red, yellow, and blue for all your different gauge wires. They're a little expensive, but they work well, and it saves me from having to solder and heat shrink. And it's not because of my lack of ability to solder and heat shrink. It's just crimp, crimp, heat, I'm done. And I've never had one let loose. So a lot of people don't like these. I don't know why. They work well. Downside is they're expensive. But time is money, I guess. And last, just like I said a second ago, I'm getting tired. I think I skipped lunch today. I had a light lunch. I don't really remember. It was busy. Oh, I think this has a maggot in it. I felt guilty, so I went out and got the brake shoe assembly out of the dumpster. I was just going to flick this brake cover thing here out. Brake inspection hole cover. And it has some kind of bug larvae growing in there. It could be the emerald ash borer beetle, which is killing all our ash trees. But I doubt it. It's probably just a stinky old maggot. And I believe it is. Oh, it's still alive. I just flicked it out right there on the bench. Let's enhance. No, I'm just kidding. Anyhow, I felt bad because I couldn't show you the brake adjuster because I already put it together. So there it is. That's your brake adjuster. That's your star wheel. And essentially, of course, this is upside down, mind you. When I was reaching through the hole from the backside, so that's right there, that's my tool. I was reaching through, turning this brake adjuster, as I'm doing right now. What a great demonstration. And as this turns, you can either increase or decrease the length of this adjuster, depending on what way you rotate it. What that's gonna do is basically spread open these shoes and take up the gap, and I think you can figure out the rest, but I felt bad because I didn't show you. I didn't want to just demonstrate it verbally with my little meat nugget trying to show you what it is. So that's what that is. And last, this is my last. If, in the event you're working on your camper, travel trailer, or electric brakes on whatever it is, and you run across these little guys that everybody in Indiana likes to use, cut them out. Do yourself a favor. Put in a butt connector. If they are not a problem now, they will be in the future, and probably in the near future. All four of those were on the left side of the trailer. And that was a side that was on the side of the road, and you know, cars are whizzing by occasionally. So I didn't do much videoing over there because my camera would have to be in the road. What it is the brake system, the brake wires typically will come back to one axle, and then from that axle it'll feed over to the other wheel. Let's say for the sake of argument, like on this setup, it came from the left front wheel, the wire did, from the main harness, came back. It goes to the left front wheel, it jumpers over to the right side via the axle tube, and the wires run straight through it. And then from there, it jumps back to the rear axle and then through the tube. So at that left front wheel, there's a multitude of connections. You have, you know, essentially two wires going in and one on the other side. So you have three wires that are going together on the back of this backing plate. So two of those wires were soldered, you know, like from the factory. Probably from Dexter is what I would assume. Dexter probably sells these camper manufacturers, these axles, and the brakes are put on. And the only reason I suspect that Dexter does it is because it has a good job. The people that put these campers together, they don't care and they do crappy work. That's just a fact of life. Every one of these things that rolls out of, I don't know, Elkhart, Indiana, or wherever it is a piece of crap. The wiring sucks. Everything is just rigged together. And they make them as fast as they can so they make as much money as possible, as quickly as they can, because that's the American motto. And, you know, presentation, craftsmanship, that's a thing of the past, unfortunately. And that really bites, because, just because it does. So, and the reason that I think Dexter puts the wires on, I may have already said this, but they're heat shrink, they're done, nice, good connection. Anything the camper manufacturer adds on, Scotch block. They just take them, you know, one, two, barbecue the things on. There's no heat shrink, there's no tape, there's no nothing. All you need is a pair of pliers, and you can give a person direction. Hook red wire to black wire, use crimp, move on with life. You know, they don't care if these things go to the salt belt. They don't care about anything like that. So if you see a Scotch lock on there, I think that's what I've always referred to them as. I don't know their technical name. You might want to post it. Somebody will post it. I know they will. Some kind of connector. If you see those, they're terrible. They're wide open. They're exposed. They just barely slice the wire to make the connection. Maybe you haven't seen one. Let me get one off the floor. I just won them. All right, here's one. So this is what they are. I call them Scotch locks. Scotch blocks. I don't know. So they open up. You can open these up. And that's the little metal tang that pierces these wires. So you stick a wire in one side, stick a wire in the other, you crimp the little metal tang in there, you flip it shut, you're done. It works, temporarily. I don't have a pair of pliers here. Let's see if I can rip it apart with my hands. I did. So I ripped it open, and that's what you have on the inside. Hopefully, let's see if I can get this to focus. That's what you have. You just have that little metal tang that cuts into the wires, and that's all the connection you have, and it leaves it exposed, and you could see how easily that wire just pulled out. That wire just sits in that little tiny groove. You just pull it out. That's the only connection you have. Now this one, somebody was nice and they stripped back the insulation. It's got a little more hope. This one, however, I think was used how this was intended to be used, which I think it just pierces the insulation, often cutting the wire, and that's what you have, is just that little metal tang that just pierces through. It's a crap design. It might work in a hurry. I never use them. I despise the things. I'd rather see a wire nut on there, and that's pretty crappy in and of itself too. So you'll see a lot of we have a lot of contractors around here. It comes through, they did wiring on her truck, you guarantee the thing's got a wire nut on it. So, anyhow, that's a lot of rambling, babbling at the end. Hope you enjoyed the video. It sure added a considerable amount of time to what it would normally take to do a brake job, and unfortunately that time is unbillable because it's my own wasted time for your benefit. But I know you guys enjoy it because you always write down in the comment box that you do, and appreciate your donations and stuff that show your appreciation. Check us out on Facebook if you haven't already. If you got a Facebook account, you can find Self-Made Auto Repair on there, and there's a link to it right here on the YouTube. You can also connect with us socially on Google+. That's pretty new to me. I'm still checking it out, so join our circles. I think that's what they say. I really don't know. And that's it. I hope you understand a little bit more on how your electric brakes work. Kind of neat. I took it for granted that I know how they work, and I was surprised the number of comments that we got where people said they didn't know how it worked. So you learn something. I learned something. You learn something. I love learning stuff. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, leave them in the comment box below. Try to get back to you as soon as I can. So just remember, viewers, if I can do it, you can do it. Thanks for watching.